Good afternoon. I'm Anastasia Levadas, and I'm the head of the photo archive here at the Frickart Reference Library. I will only be briefly discussing the history and the scope of the photo archive collection, our digital holdings, and the impetus for our collaboration with Stanford University in hopes to provide some context for the project. The photo archive is a steady collection of over 1.2 million photographic reproductions of works of art from the 4th to mid-20th century by artists trained in the Western tradition. Each image or work of art is accompanied by rich historical documentation, often tracing changes in attribution, ownership, and condition. The images, together with the historical information, provide an unparalleled resource for the study of the history of art. The physical collection consists of two types of materials. About a third of the collection is mounted on gray archival board. These works have the richest documentation and are assigned or labeled a local classification heading which describes the subject of the work of art and serves as an access point for discovery and retrieval. The other two-thirds of the collection consists of loose unmounted reproductions with minimal documentation, and while these are physically arranged in folders by general subject, they are essentially unclassified. And here you see examples of each. As Louisa mentioned, through several grant-funded projects, approximately 40% of the collection has been digitized and is available through Fresco and NIARC Discovery, the library's online catalog and discovery layer, and through the Frick Digital Collection site, our digital repository. By the end of this year, we estimate that this figure will rise to 60% with the completion of a project funded by the Mellon Foundation to digitize and catalog an additional 250,000 items from the collection. This will include all of the classified or mounted reproductions of paintings and drawings. Concurrently, the library's in-house digital conservation lab is also digitizing the loose reproductions. And photo archive staff is tasked with creating cataloging records for each work of art from the digital images. As we began cataloging this material, we quickly realized that analyzing and assigning one of over 500 classification headings to each image was the most consuming task in our workflow, and also extremely daunting with over 200,000 works of art in our cataloging queue. As most of you know, digitization often outpaces cataloging and metadata creation. Faced with this challenge, and after a series of meetings with the Stanford team, we provided them with a sample data set of 28,000 American portraits with 98 unique classification headings assigned to them, so that through deep learning, the computer can be trained to apply them to our unclassified digitized holdings. Here's an example. Just some of the examples, some of the loose photographs or reproductions in the collection, and also a snippet of what our classification headings look like. Our hope is that with collaborations such as this one and others described here today, we can leverage our existing digital holdings to streamline metadata creation and fulfill our mission to make our collections available and discoverable to the public. And with that, here is XY and Vardan to discuss their findings.
Hello, my name is Vardan. What? Oh, yeah. And this is XY. And our topic for today is experiences with deep learning for multi-labeled art classification. And this is a joint work with Rick Johnson and David Donnell, both of whom are in the crowd. And I would like to thank Jaime Lozano for the graphics. So let's begin with a small game, which we call Guess the Labels. And could the audience please help me label this fine gentleman in the picture? Shout out the answers.
Yes. Come on.
Good enough. Yes. Thank you. Let's try another one. Can the audience guess which labels match this pretty lady?
With hats, yes.
Close enough. Okay. So currently, thousands of these images are being classified manually by hand by the freak photo archivists. And our goal is to help them. And the way we're going to do that is by utilizing an algorithm that has become super popular in recent years, which is called deep learning. This algorithm led to many state-of-the-art results in different fields, in different tasks, as we've seen throughout the conference, often reaching superhuman performance. So basically, this algorithm obtains as input a certain data set. In our case, this is the portraits collection of the freak, which includes two things, images of different people, together with their corresponding label. And this algorithm trains to map every image to its corresponding label, so that once we give it a new image that wasn't seen during training, the algorithm would be able to map it to its corresponding labels. Notice that the more data you give, the better this algorithm behaves. So what we're proposing here is a paradigm shift. Instead of manually labeling the tens of thousands of images of the freak photo archive manually, all you need to do is acquire a subset of these labels and use these as training examples for the deep learning algorithm. You train the network on this subset of images, and then you use it to predict all the remaining labels. At this point, you have a label for each image in the data set, and if the deep learning algorithm has certain mistakes, you could then use, again, human involvement in order to fix them. XY, take it away.
Okay, so we ran multiple experiments for this task, so which ones of the 36 labels apply, and this is the results visualized from our best experiment. This is VGG for those who are curious, and we just have the men label, and you see that the parts of the image that activates the network the most when we're looking for the label men is the face, and when we're looking for hands, on the other hand, it's really the hands. So it makes sense, and the network is doing something intelligent, and if you notice, it's also adjusting to the different orientations of the hands and faces. So as Vardan mentioned, as many previous speakers mentioned, this whole process is very dependent on how much training data we have. If we have too few, it's a very quick process to train, but you have very bad results. For example, for the four-length label, we only have 95 examples of that, and you see a lot of false positives and missed positives. At the same time, when you have 12,000, you do very well, but that's 12,000 things you have to label. Right? So our goal is really to help the Frick photo archivist, but really the community, save the most time overall and to find that sweet spot where everything's efficient. Right? And so that means, how many samples do we need? Yesterday, the speakers always emphasized, oh, millions from ImageNet, that's how we found the cards, right? But how much do we need for the Frick? We can give you an answer. So basically, we trained the network on increasingly larger training sets, and then we tested it on a testing set that the network has never seen. And if you see that if we just give it 10 examples of a label, for example, for the men, we do around 43% accuracy, which is actually about the same as what you would get if you just said there's no men at all, ever. And so I'm sure many people would be happy with that. But but as you increase the number of examples in the training data, the accuracy increases until by 5,000 examples for men, you get to 93% accuracy. And by what our full training data set of 12,000, you get to 95%. And so, here's our goals. Using the results we just saw earlier, augmented by statistical theories and insights, we hope to work with the photo archivists to really find that sweet spot I mentioned earlier, where everyone's just not spending too much time labeling, nor are they spending too much time correcting. And afterwards, we hope to extend this research to not only the North American portraits, but more portions of the Frick photo archive. And much of this is, I guess, much of what we learned through one portion of the images will be transferable to another. And I think Matthew might touch on that later. And lastly, because the tech community has evolved so much, what the ultimate, I guess, grand slam for this is we envision one day to really automate this process and to create this, I guess, application-based interface where first we automatically label the hundreds of thousands of images in the photo archive, and then the archivist can just go through, scroll through, and like check the labels, swipe left if this is right, swipe right if I need to fix this myself. And this will be quick, and this will save everybody time and I think make everybody happy, which is the goal in the end, right? So that's our hope, and that's it, and we look forward to see where this is going. Thank you very much.